Days into the presidency, an executive order to increase manpower on the border and expand the wall.
We want safe communities, and we demand safe communities for everyone.
One border mayor says it'll cause a domino effect.
A slap like this to Mexico does not help. It's a negative move.
And changes to the Affordable Care Act. What's the impact to Arizona?
This is a dramatic time for our industry, and there are real repercussions for people.
The state's plan should the feds tighten up healthcare spending. This is Arizona Week. Hello, and thanks for joining us. President Donald Trump in office for a week, and among his first orders of business, healthcare and border enforcement. First to the border are the 3 points from the president's plan to improve border security: expand the wall along the border, hire more Border Patrol agents, and triple the number of ICE agents. The president's plan met with resistance and a bit of a Twitter war via social media between Mexican President Enrique Peña Nieto and the president. First, President Trump tweeted, "If Mexico is unwilling to pay for a badly needed wall, then it would be better to cancel the upcoming meeting." Shortly thereafter, Mexico's president tweeted that he had canceled a meeting with President Trump scheduled for next week. In Arizona, there are more than 4,000 Border Patrol agents and 350 miles of international line. In the Tucson sector, that's primarily southern Arizona, it's reported that 210 miles currently have a wall, fence, or vehicle barrier. President Trump, though, not backing down, saying this executive order will improve both the U.S. and Mexico.
I want to emphasize that we will be working in partnership with our friends in Mexico to improve safety and economic opportunity on both sides of the border.
A plan the president says is part of immigration reform, and one he says will save thousands of lives, millions of jobs, and billions of dollars.
This coordination includes the dismantling of cartels and keeping illegal weapons and cash from flowing out of America and into Mexico. Beginning today, the United States of America gets back control of its borders, gets back its borders.
A matter of safety, the president says, for the U.S. and Mexico.
As I've said repeatedly to the country, we are going to get the bad ones out, the criminals and the drug deals and gangs and gang members and cartel leaders. The day is over when they can stay in our country and wreak havoc. We are going to get them out, and we're going to get them out fast.
None of the president's plan, though, is necessary, according to the mayor of Nogales, Arizona.
It's not going to be any difference of what they're doing now. They go over the wall. If they can go through it, they will. They can go under, whatever it is. They built a 20-foot wall, they'll come up with a 25-foot ladder.
Mayor John Doyle says calls for more enforcement hurt already existing cross-border relationships at the local level.
All of Mexico could be a buffer zone for us. If we have them, if we have their cooperation, if we have their respect, and that's something that local communities like ours that go from Tijuana down to Brownsville have been working on keeping good relationships with Mexico. Through Nogales, our Mariposa port of entry, the biggest port of entry in Arizona, we have billions of dollars coming through here.
A community that relies on trade, businesses here get about 80% of their business from Mexican shoppers.
The trade is just growing, and a slap like this to Mexico does not help. It's a negative move, and we will be affected, nationally. A lot of them can be lost. There's a lot of communities that all of a sudden a lot of the shops are going to be closed because it's going to affect the local economy.
For more of our coverage on the president's executive order regarding the border, visit our website, news.azpm.org. On to other news now, the Affordable Care Act. President Trump announced plans to, quote, ease the burden on the healthcare industry. Arizona is one of 31 states that expanded its Medicaid program under the ACA. So how will Arizona respond to any changes? And Christina Corrieri from the governor's office, a senior policy advisor, joins me now. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
You just returned from D.C. Tell me a little bit about what your goal was as you were there.
I did. You know, the goal was to make sure that Arizona has a seat at the table as Congress begins this important debate of repealing and replacing Obamacare. States are the closest to their citizens. So we see the effects of healthcare reform, whether it's people calling into our office because they can't afford their plan anymore and the premium hike that they've seen, or whether it's in state budgets with the programs that we supply. We are the ones that are closest to the people, and we want to make sure that the voice of the state and the input that we can give is there. That didn't really happen the first time around. Mm. Now we have a Vice President Pence, who was a governor himself. He understands this. The Congress understands this. Leader McCarthy actually engaged the states in a way that we didn't see back in 2009 and 2010. He sent a letter to all of the states asking for input on some very specific questions, which Arizona was happy to provide. And we're going to continue that engagement throughout the process.
I was able to see that letter from Governor Ducey to Leader McCarthy, and I noticed that he refers to Arizona as ground zero for negative impact of the ACA. What exactly does he mean by that?
Well, when the ACA was passed, President Obama promised the country, really, that what we would see was more competition, more choice, and lower prices. And that wasn't what we saw. The whole country experienced that, but Arizona especially. So if you look at choice, Arizona had over 24 companies selling in the individual market before 2014, when the exchanges were implemented. If you fast forward to this year, we're down to a single carrier for the individual market in 14 of our 15 counties. When you talk about costs, President Obama had said you're going to see your premiums decrease by about $2,000. That absolutely is not the case anywhere. We actually got increases, but Arizona had the highest increases. You saw people with 116% increase with costs for insurance that are higher than their mortgage, and then facing a deductible of $7,000, $8,000, $10,000 for a family. So that's why we've called Arizona ground zero, and that's why it's so important that we share this information with the federal government.
What are you advising Governor Ducey on doing next? Is the hope for repeal and replace?
Absolutely, the hope is for repeal and replace. I don't think that any serious person, whether it's in Arizona or DC, is talking about repeal in isolation. There's always that replacement with it. So we're very focused on making sure that that's a replacement that works for everyone and doesn't pull the rug out from anyone.
There are a handful of Arizona lawmakers that I've interviewed who have said that if this changes dramatically, Arizona could be stuck footing the bill and it could be upwards of $1 billion. Is that correct?
Well, so what those lawmakers aren't saying is that that figure only applies if it was a straight up repeal without a replacement. And again, that's not something that I hear being discussed here, and that's not something I hear being discussed in DC. So I think that that number is incredibly hypothetical, and it assumes a lot of things that are just not accurate.
Are plans in place to find some funding that would go toward that should the ACA be replaced?
Well, plans are in place on what that replacement should be, and a big piece of that is going to be financing, but also flexibility for states. So we don't know what those numbers will look like, but as the plans start to develop and as we start to see proposals, we're going to be constantly evaluating them for their impact on Arizona.
The ACA has provided health care to tens of thousands of Arizonans. Mm-hmm. Should it change? Should it be replaced? What is the message to those people, that public?
Well, the message that Governor Ducey has consistently said is that we don't want to see the rug pulled out from anyone. He's also said that there needs to be a sufficient time period for this transition to take place. So, for example, if the federal government allows for more flexibility in plan design, these plans for insurance companies, they simply don't exist today, and they won't exist tomorrow because they have to have time to put those together. Even once that happens, those have to be reviewed by state departments of insurance, and some of their review deadlines in some states start as early as May 1st. It will be very difficult to get plans that are available come January 1st of next year. You're probably talking about a 2 to 3 year time period. So in that interim, we also want to make sure that those who are receiving coverage continue to receive coverage, and that means extending the subsidies for that interim period.
As you mentioned, Obamacare, and that's a term that's used, mm-hmm. it depends on semantics, but this is a Republican state that supported Affordable Care Act when it came into existence. Republican governor, this isn't political though, is it?
Well, I think that you could say that Arizona adopted certain parts of the Affordable Care Act. They certainly didn't embrace and adjust all of them. In some ways, the Affordable Care Act usurped a lot of state power. So before states said how the insurance regulations would work, they decided benefit management. Those were all usurped by the federal government, and states didn't get a say. And I really don't see a lot of people in Arizona saying that that was a good thing. There were certain pieces of the ACA that Arizona did adopt, and you know, we will have conversations about those.
Okay, Christina Corrieri, the Senior Policy Advisor to Governor Ducey, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Open enrollment for the Affordable Care Act ends next week on January 31st. Before the Affordable Care Act, 1.2 million Arizonans were without insurance. Today, that number is about 770,000 people. Here's Dr. Dan Dirksen from the University of Arizona Center for Rural Health.
My contention is that you don't save money by throwing people off of health insurance. You just shift the cost of taking care of that population to rural and critical access hospitals, to physicians, nurses, others that, as part of their mission, take care of people regardless of ability to pay. So it disproportionately affects, though, our rural areas and populations, our vulnerable populations. So,
is it fair to say the Affordable Care Act has been effective for Arizona? I mean, Medicaid expansion occurred, and as you said, it did help some of those smaller hospitals get to where they...
Well, it helped, first and foremost, the individual that didn't have health insurance before. We know from studies that the evidence is clear and compelling that when you have coverage, whether it's a public sponsor like Medicare or Medicaid, or if it's a private health insurance, the health outcomes improve when you have coverage. So, first and foremost, the thing to remember is this is hundreds of thousands of Arizonans who gained coverage over the last couple of years. So if you look at the metric, the outcome measure of increase in coverage, we've almost halved our uninsured in Arizona over the last 3 years. We've reduced the number of choices. The premiums doubled. The low-income individuals that are enrolled in those plans are largely shielded from those increases because of the way the advanced premium tax credit works and the subsidies that come forward. So those less than 250% of the federal poverty level don't feel that increase as much, but certainly those, and about one out of five of those 200,000 or so Arizonans that are paying their premiums in the federally facilitated marketplace, one out of five doesn't get any subsidy. They're above 400% of the federal poverty level. They don't get a subsidy.
Because premiums have increased and choices have shrunk, doesn't that indicate that there is something wrong with the ACA?
But what I always remind people, even though about half of Arizonans and half of Americans in general get their health insurance or employer-sponsored insurance, you know, often employers aren't offering more than one or two plans. So it's really no different than how the majority of Americans get coverage. Personally, I would like to see more competition. When we had at least seven insurers offering 70 different plans in Arizona, we had the second lowest silver premiums in the country for the federally facilitated marketplace. So the market was working, but some folks underpriced their health plans. They didn't get enough people enrolling in it to spread the risk across a large enough population. They lost money, became nervous. Insurers jumped out.
What are the potential effects to places like Bisbee, Sierra Vista, should the ACA undergo some sort of transformation?
Two out of three rural voters voted for Donald Trump. And it's always wise for a politician to pay attention to the constituents that voted you into office. We have not paid attention to our rural health infrastructure for many years. We have an opportunity now. And there's some very specific things we can do. One of them is not remove the coverage gains that we've made. Let's build on those coverage gains. Let's get better value out of those, as we're trying to do in the contracting process through our state's Medicaid program and access. More and more, they're looking for not just paying a fee for a service every time someone gets seen, but trying to create incentives and rewards for providers and hospitals and systems to do better on population health outcomes. Did you get your screening mammogram, your screening pap? Did you get your cholesterol checked? Is your diabetes under control? Is your blood pressure under control? just dealing with some of the major cost drivers in a population management episode, not just every time you see something, every time you get a procedure, every time you get a test, something's paid for, but are you paying attention and reaching out to those individuals who may not show up there through community health workers and others? Can we pay attention to those and through our contracting process, pay folks to keep people healthy?
Part of, as I understand it, part of President Trump's plan was to help the insurance companies, to help the healthcare industry. Is that what was needed at this time, given, you know, the ACA has been in place for a couple years now?
So there are some very specific things that insurers have been asking for. The thing is that what you can't do is remove those incentives that keep people paying premiums. You can't make automobile insurance work if people only pay for their insurance when they get in an automobile accident. Similarly, you can't make health insurance work if people only pay when they need an operation or need a lab test or need a medication paid for. So that's part of the thing that's unpopular, is people having to pay essentially a tax penalty for not having coverage. But if you don't create the revenue source in some way to cover that uninsured and uncompensated care, all you're going to add to is for even employer-sponsored insurance. The estimate is that about $1,000 for a family of four premium is related to those who don't have health insurance, because the hospitals, the physicians, the nurses have to figure out a way to make it work for those who can't afford to pay, who don't have coverage, with those who do. And so if we don't address it in one way, by coverage or keeping coverage or expanding it, we'll pay for it somewhere else. So these are not straightforward issues and with simple answers. A slogan is not going to cure the ills of addressing the issues that we haven't addressed for some years. Is that there are consequences to making some of these changes, and they're trying to translate in very real terms. If you do this and don't pay attention to this, here's what happens fiscally, and hopefully there's health providers and individuals who explain, you know, how that really plays out at the individual or family level when people don't have health insurance coverage. They don't have access to preventive services and primary care. You pay for it down the road in real human terms.
Repealing or changing the Affordable Care Act in any way will impact healthcare in Arizona. That's according to one of Southern Arizona's largest hospitals and a group that's committed to providing the best care to patients. Here are Julia Strange from Tucson Medical Center and retired physician Dr. Daniel McCabe, representing Arizona Connected Care. Well, my thanks to both of you for being here. Let's start off, Julia, at TMC. Has the Affordable Care Act been effective for the hospital?
Tucson Medical Center believes the Affordable Care Act has been very beneficial. Arizona is in a position, unlike some other states, to really have a good picture of what Medicaid expansion has meant for hospitals across the state. If you'll recall, during the recession, the Medicaid population was frozen, and so it dropped dramatically. During that time, hospitals' charity care escalated. At TMC, it rose to a point of $25.9 million. When we expanded and when we restored and expanded Medicaid, that number has consistently come down. And last year, it was at 8 million. So that's a dramatic improvement. Now, it's important to remember that we also helped fund the Medicaid restoration through the hospital assessment. So it's not as big of a win as it sounds, but it is definitely positive for Tucson Medical Center, and it's allowed us to invest in our community.
Dr. McCabe, you recently retired from practicing medicine. Tell me a little bit about how the ACA may have helped or changed the way you practice toward the end of your career.
Well, at the end of my career, as innovation has gone forward and there's been improvements, there's been a lot more paperwork. Physicians spend more and more time at the end of the day catching up on their paperwork, particularly in the electronic medical records first version, which is very frustrating because it takes you away from the true thing that you love to do, which is taking care of patients.
Tell me about your work now with the Arizona Connected Care.
So Arizona Connected Care is an accountable care organization that was started by the ACA. Our job is really to make patient outcomes, improve those, make quality as high as possible. We also strive to be very efficient and drive costs down. and then we want the patient experience to improve.
Is that one example you would say that how the ACA has worked hand in hand with local hospitals like Tucson Medical Center?
Yes, the ACA has spiked the punch a little bit to make it more intriguing, it gives us an incentive to improve things. The marketplace in itself is also doing that on the commercial side, so businesses, the purchasers of healthcare are becoming very interested in the cost of care, how much they have to pay in premiums, how their employees are being treated. So there's a whole nother underpinning going on that's accelerating this care.
Julia, that relationship that's been built, should the ACA be repealed or changed, what are the possible impacts?
We recognize that the ACA is going to be repealed and replaced. We are encouraging that that be done simultaneously so as to minimize disruption in the healthcare system. When you talk about the politics around the ACA, when you talk about the business of healthcare, it's important to always remember that the reason there is this thing called the healthcare industry and the reason that there is healthcare insurance is because there are individuals who are receiving care that can be life-saving. It's important to keep the system stable so we don't threaten all of our communities by not having the health care we need when we need it.
Dr. McCabe, do you agree that it could be repealed?
Oh, absolutely. It would slow down our progress, but again, we're still committed to it, and so even if it was repealed, we would still continue our work.
What is the effect on the patients?
I think it'll be more chaotic for the patients. It'll be harder for them to get themselves through the healthcare minefield, and it'll increase costs.
Julia, oftentimes we hear that this is political, but for you at Tucson Medical Center, it's not political, it's business. This is what you do as far as providing healthcare.
You know, it's interesting. When the ACA was being debated originally, Judy Rich is my boss, and she said, "What should we do about this political debate?" And I said, "I think we need to start to reform healthcare from the ground up. We'll let Washington do what it does, but we need to make our voice heard, but we also need to really take proactive steps to improve the health of our community." And part of that was our work with the Arizona Connected Care, and we've seen really positive, real results. It's driving value over volume, making sure that people are making the right decisions so people are getting the right care in the right place at the right time. And it's also making sure that people are accountable for their health care. So we're promoting healthy lifestyles. We're decreasing the rate of diabetes by helping people manage their weight and making those important decisions. So I think that there is clearly healthcare will always be political, but at the community level, there's an opportunity for us to come together and make real change and improve the lives of the people around us.
Well, we would add to that that what we have really learned over the last 5 years is that people who have health insurance are engaged in their mm-hmm. care, and they have reason to be engaged in their care. And that produces better outcomes, but it also produces lower costs. So anything that makes healthcare more restrictive, harder to get entrance into, is only going to be destructive.
A lot of the times we have people from the outside telling us how to do our jobs. I imagine that must be how you feel, Dr. McCabe. What do you think would work? How can we fix healthcare?
Well, I think healthcare, the first thing we need to realize is this is a 10-year project. This is not going to get better in a short period of time. We've made tremendous progress. We've gotten significant savings in the total cost of care for a lot of contracts for a lot of insurers. And that process is just going to take multiple years.
And I think one of the things that's important for Tucson to know and for Arizona to know is that Arizona is really a model for efficient and effective care, not only in Medicaid, but throughout our system. And it's one of the reasons that Washington so frequently looks to Arizona for how do we improve, how do we make the system work. The governor has been a leader in this, and we applaud him for that. Access is recognized across the country as a gold standard, and so we're fortunate to have such an efficient system, and really one that can be a model for the country in terms of how we can move forward effectively.
When you remove those political lenses, if you will, that look at this issue, what needs to happen next? What should really be that discussion happening at the dinner table or in the boardrooms where these decisions are being made?
We support both the chicken and the egg, because it needs to occur at multiple levels. And I think it needs a patient who has a good relationship with a primary care provider who they can rely on, who they can trust to. The primary care provider needs to be incentivized to spend time with the patients, not feel like they're on a treadmill. That at the ground roots level is the best place to start.
Dr. McCabe, would you say that feeling as though you're on a treadmill, did that start with the ACA? Was it slowly coming right before?
Well, I think in the desire to become efficient, there are certain people who have the theory that if you just, the best way to become efficient is cut price. And as you cut price, you still have to provide care. And then you start to get on a negative treadmill that doesn't allow it. Instead of the accountable care organizations, you're allowed to sit back, think, and make good decisions. So like the construction industry, you measure twice and cut once instead of just cut as fast as you can.
Julia, how does TMC sort of prepare for the next few months when we continue to dissect what's happening with the Affordable Care Act?
I would say TMC is preparing both by being proactive and constructive part of the dialogue. We are informing those people who are making these decisions in Washington. We are actively having those conversations. But really the core business of TMC is to create a safe hospital that is available and accessible. And so while we are certainly focused on the larger political debate, it's very important for us to remain critically focused on our core work and making sure that we have the safest, most efficient hospital that is here for the community and will be for many years to come.
In the interest of transparency, is there a storm cloud that's headed this direction as a result of a repeal or just transforming the Affordable Care Act?
The transformation could be positive, could be negative. The devil's in the details. So do I worry at night? Yes.
Julia?
Absolutely. You know, to not worry and not be concerned about this and not be a part of the conversation and the solution would be foolish. This is a dramatic time for our industry, and there are real repercussions for people and for both as patients and as jobs in our community. And so, yes, there is great concern.
And that's our program. Thank you for watching. For all of us at Arizona Public Media, I'm Lorraine Rivera. Thanks for joining us.